Hey guys, Crypto Crazy here. Just wanted to provide you with a quick update on how things are progressing, not just with liquid lines, but also on the Fetch front. So you would have experienced, and certainly just in the last video that I was on with WALLRUS, we did discuss the whole redemptions issue, and the team is working really hard to try and get some things resolved in terms of the price fee. To provide a little bit more context, effectively, the reasons the redemptions actually happen is that there's an opportunity in the market to actually make some money. So there's a lot of people that have created bots that look for opportunities to actually acquire Pulse at a discount and do so in a way that they can then offload that and generate some yield for themselves. And, you know, whilst, you know, we expect that these things tend to happen, we have noticed a lot of that. So there are a lot of bots running, trying to look at opportunities to redeem sort of users of the protocols, which on one level is a little bit unfortunate, but on another it's understandable that that would happen. So one of the things that we've been able to do is actually improve the speed of the price fit. Now, what does that actually do? It basically means that the opportunity, the window of opportunity to actually redeem Pulse from the system is actually narrowed significantly. So when we initially launched, we used the same sort of environment that was used over at Liquity on Ethereum. But we've come to realize that, look, because of the relative newness of PulseChain itself, it's a fairly immature chain in relative terms, in terms of the time it's been around, the amount of volatility that has occurred, particularly of late. So we've seen the prices increase dramatically. And whilst we started initially with a price bid that incorporated a time-weighted average, the reality is that we knew that if the price moves very quickly, a time-weighted basically drags the price down in terms of what's ingested by liquid loans. The long and the short of it is it creates more of an opportunity for people to actually be redeemed, and so we needed to narrow that window. Now, we had hoped to get something concluded by the end of March. Now, the guys have worked really, really hard to actually get something working now. And so we've introduced something over the last couple of days that has significantly reduced the opportunity for people to be redeemed against. And we're starting to notice that now. So for people that want to see the progression over time, we have introduced a couple of new charts in the front end. So if you go to the analytics page, you can actually scroll down to the bottom. There's a couple of new charts that we introduced, one of which is to do with APR. So the APR for the stability pool, we wanted to show the difference between the annualized result, which is my preference to look at because it shows the progression over the entire year, compared with the weekly results. The weekly result is much more narrower in focus, obviously, and it shows you the more immediate returns. And if you have a look at that graph, it starts to show quite a difference between the weekly returns relative to the annualized returns. Nothing new in that. We just wanted to provide users with a bit more context around how the returns are coming through. So that is a new chart that was introduced. The more interesting one is the one where we've actually introduced a very clear view of what's happening on the redemption front. And if you look at some of the history where we've had significant spikes in prices, you'll notice that there's a lot more what we call partial redemptions and full redemption. Now, full redemption is where all of your debt's paid off, and you've acquired all the USDL, but you've also been redeemed against. It doesn't mean you lose all your PLS, it just means that your debt's been paid, and you can then use that debt to reacquire Pulse if you wish. Personally, that happened to me. Whilst it was a little bit frustrating at the time, it wasn't too hard for me then to just wait for a pullback. I was able to reacquire my Pulse. So no real harm done, other than the nuisance value of all of that process. And you know, this marginal cost that I had to incur with gas fees, but outside of that, it wasn't catastrophic. It was just something that I had to do. I'd anticipate other users have been doing the same. So we would urge you to do that. If you ever are redeemed, just make sure that, okay, be aware of a new position and then potentially reacquire the Pulse, you know, when there's a pullback, and you should be able to restore your position reasonably quickly. Having said that, it is frustrating. And so what we're trying to do is reduce the amount of opportunities for players in the market to actually make those gains from redemption. So we've narrowed the window significantly. And you'll start to see that in the second chart that actually shows partial redemptions, full redemptions, and liquidations. There's not many liquidations, so we've noticed that people have taken the idea that, hey, you don't want to have an individual collateral ratio that's too low that potentially places you at risk in terms of being liquidated. So we're not seeing a hell of a lot of that, but obviously we've seen a fair few redemptions occur. But over the course of the last few days, we've noticed a downward trend there, and that's really exciting for us in some respects because it means that people won't be redeemed against as often. It's not to say it's not going to happen. It will happen. It does happen. And the whole concept of the protocol is the idea of having a redemption is actually to help with ensuring that USDL maintains its peg. So it is a necessary part of the protocol, but you never want to be subjected to a redemption if you can help it. If you're wanting to use the system in its entirety, our recommendation would be to keep the debt in front at a reasonable level. But what you'll start to notice now is because of that reduced time period for people to be redeemed against, the number of redemptions will fall dramatically. And you'll start to see people coming in, creating vaults at lower individual collateral ratios as a result of that, because it just means that the likelihood of being redeemed isn't as great as it was when there was a bigger difference between the ingested price and the actual spot price of PLS. So we've done that. We've managed to be able to sort that out within a very short period of time because we knew that it was something that was quite important for us to address. So we've managed to do that. The other thing that I wanted to address is probably more to do with how people are using the protocol or some of the things that people may not be fully aware of with regards to the protocol. Probably the biggest thing that I've noticed is people are actually using the stability pool to acquire the loan tokens, and the issuance is quite high in the first year, but they're then looking to offload the loan token, which is actually meaning that it's putting down the pressure on the loan itself. Loan token is a yield-bearing token. Now, what does that really mean? What it means is whatever yields you are getting in return for having the loan token, is it actually paid to you in the loan token itself? So there's no pressure for you to sell the loan token. It's more beneficial for you particularly in this particular part of the year, it's best to actually start acquiring more. And then you'd ask, well, why would you want to acquire more loan token? Well, it's because of how yields are being paid out. So there is an issuance, but there's also, once you've acquired the loan token, when people are sort of looking at how does loan get its yield, it gets its yield based on PLS and also USDL. Now, the USDL happens when people actually take out a loan. Now, as the price of Pulse increases, and we're all quite hopeful that PLS will actually continue to rise in value, and particularly over the next 6 to 12 months, my expectation is that Pulse will outperform most other chains in this time frame. And when it does that, there'll be more need, or people may want to extract value. And if they're looking to extract value, the best way of doing it is just to take that loan and never sell your Pulse. So when that occurs, because the value of Pulse has increased so much, the size of these loans may be higher. And the USDL paid to people that are retaining their loan tokens is going to be higher as well. And you have to remember the loan token, it's a capped supply, right? It's not inflating, it's a cap supply. So once all the loan tokens have been issued, there's no further loan token going to be issued. And as a result of that, the people that actually have loan token are the main beneficiaries of those, the yields that they'll get both in terms of PLS from redemptions, but also from the USDL that they'll get from the issuance fees that occur when people take out loans. So the idea, personally, I think the idea would be acquire as much loan token as you can, stake it. Make sure that you're getting PLS from redemptions and you're also getting USDL from the issuance. And that's a really nice, solid way of acquiring the loan. Now, the other way to think about the loan token is it also has a halving schedule. So you've probably heard about Bitcoin having a halving period. So it halves in terms of the rewards that are paid to miners. And that happens at a certain interval. Loan tokens is issued in the same manner. It has a halving schedule. So every year, the amount of the loan token that's issued is actually halved. So next year, the amount of issuance will be significantly less than what it currently is. and that continues until the total supply is actually exhausted. So people that hold loan and acquire loan, effectively you're getting a larger slice of the pie. And the pie that you're getting is the opportunity to acquire Pulse from any redemptions that do occur, and also from the issuance fees that come through the loans that are likely to be growing in value over time, and that's going to be paid to you in USDL. So both of those things combined are really worthwhile thinking about if you are acquiring a loan. And if you are a user of the protocol, my view is that's how you maximise your returns, is you keep acquiring a loan, particularly in this year where the issuance rate is a lot higher. And for me, that will mean that you'll get better rewards and returns over time, particularly as the value of the Pulse increases. The other thing that we did want to point out is that, you know, I'd like to refer to them as our baby brother. So the guys over at PowerCity have actually launched a very similar protocol that addresses the opportunity of doing similar sort of things with PulseX. And the guys have actually, I think it's only been out for about a week, but they're doing quite well. A number of vaults open there. It's a lower entry level, so worthwhile having a look at that as well. So guys, again, thank you very much for your time. Hopefully you've been able to navigate the protocol today. Again, urge you to not only have a look at PowerCity, but we know that the Barista guys have also created a front end for liquid loans. So have a look at that as well. There's some mechanics there to help automate certain transactions. So well worth your while exploring that. And we're really happy to see more activity on the chain as well. So guys, hopefully this has been helpful. Look forward to catching up again in the future. Thanks a lot.